turn to. We all need that same love, and I could give you some, so let me give you some. Wake up and I'm wanting to be something bigger. Keep on getting blinded by the negative. My mind is on the run, I gotta learn to sprint. If I wanna win, if I wanna win. Mama always.
This is the Moondrop Blessing 2 Dusk. This is a revision on an existing iem, the Moondrop Blessing 2, which in itself was a sequel of the Blessing 1. I should start by saying I've received this as a Lonator unit. I didn't pay for this, I'm not being paid to say anything about this, and I don't get to keep them. I've got to send them off to the next person in a couple of days' time. I literally just have this for the duration of this review. All thoughts and opinions are my own. I did, however, own the original Blessings. I've not tried the Blessing 2, so unfortunately I won't be able to give a direct comparison to those, but the Blessing 1s I will. I had the Blessing 1s for about a year. I liked them a lot. They were a very well-priced, overall well-performing IEM, with the possible exception of base. They were an all-BA IEM that didn't do too well in the low end. This, as you can see, is a BA dynamic driver hybrid, and so I'll get on to whether or not that changes things in a short while. I'm going to structure this review. Going to go over the build and packaging first, then I'm going to go over bass, mids, treble, space, and how much fun they are. In that order, and I'll get to what those last two things mean a little while later. So, let's start with packaging. This is the case that comes with them. It's pretty spacious. Obviously, you take this foam insert out. You've got some room for some adapters and stuff up here. It's fairly minimal branding. Some cases and stuff go way too far with their branding. This one's pretty nice, so I like that a lot. The actual box itself is kind of pretty nice, fairly premium feeling. It's a nice step up over the original Blessings. The original Blessing, you've got this sort of wood box with some straw in it, and it was a nice design, but it did feel a little bit unorthodox. So that's a lot better. You also get these, some little black discs and some tweezers, and I'll get on to why in a moment. Let's talk about the cable. So the cable was the first thing that started to go wrong. As you can see, I put these down for half a second, and already they're twisting and starting to tangle a little bit. That is because this cable has a lot of shape memory. If I hold it like that, you can see it's not particularly soft. It holds its shape fairly well. It looks pretty nice. It's kind of shiny copper type material, but it really doesn't feel great. It tangles so easily, especially this splitter. This splitter is round and yet somehow catches on everything. God knows how they've achieved that. Would definitely recommend changing the cable, which is pretty easy because it's just a standard 2-pin connection. You can use any replacement cable you like. You can get some cheap Yinyu stuff on eBay, or you can get a nice custom one. So yeah, not too hard to swap out. Not a massive problem, but would recommend doing so. The build of the IEM itself is a very different story. It's a lovely brushed metal finish. The actual IEM itself is a molded pseudo-custom design. So it's not full-on earbud or anything, but it's also not to the same level as an Anola VX or an in-ear Stage Diver 5 would be. Those two IEMs just straight up feel like customs. This one is very, very comfortable, but it's not too molded. This is also one of the few IEMs I can lie down with. If I hold it like that, you can kind of see. It doesn't look like you'd be able to, because it looks pretty big, but actually, surprisingly, this is one of the few IEMs I can lie on my side quite comfortably whilst wearing. So that's a nice surprise. They are very comfortable, but the problem you're going to have is the bore is extremely wide. A lot of people have complained that they actually can't get these to fit because the bore of the nozzle is just too thick for their ear canals. I have fairly kind of medium-sized ear canals, and I've got to use the smallest tips, else they don't fit. So if you've got pretty narrow ear canals, you might not be able to get these to work at all. It comes with a few different sizes of tips. God knows who's going to be using the larger ones. As I said, the nozzle's huge. And then that brings us onto this. So it comes with several replacement filters. Normally, these are part of the structure of the IEM itself. Some IEMs you can replace them yourself. Some of the IEMs you can't. These ones, they are just adhered to the top of the nozzle. And I'm not going to take the tips off and show you, because every time you take the tips off, there's a sort of 50-50 chance that you're going to take the damn filter off, which is why they give you so many replacements, because you're going to need them. This is a Lonator unit, and as you can see, three have been used already, one of which was me changing the tips to get them to fit. And yeah, these aren't going to be ideal if you're the sort of person who likes to tip roll, because every time you take the tips off, you might take the filter off. And I don't know what happens if you run out. I'm sure you could probably get some more from Moondrop, but it might be a hassle. So that's worth noting. I love the build of the iems. The build of the iems is fantastic, but there's just a couple design quirks. That wide nozzle, the weird filter attachment, it's literally just stuck on the top, is questionable. I like that they're changeable. I like that you can change them yourself. I just wish that they weren't quite so prone to coming off. Anyway, I've been listening to these mostly with the Holo Audio May, which is my main DAC, and the GDS Atom. I wouldn't use the AHB2 for iems just because speaker amp and iems, not going to go too well. But for most full-size headphones, that's what I'd use. I've also got the Core Dave in at the moment, and I did try them on the headphone amp of that. The headphone amp on the Dave is just okay, but I've been using both DACs, mostly with this amp though, so it's been quite interesting. They don't need a lot of power. You don't need much to run them at all, and I've had plenty of success running them off the Apple dongle. Apple dongle is absolutely fine, more than enough headroom. So for portable use, you really don't need anything particularly beefy, which is great. Okay, so how do they sound? As I said, I'm going to go over bass, mids, treble, space, and then fun. There's three main aspects to bass. Speed, how fast the actual bass is, how swiftly the initial impact is, how clean and crisp, snappy, some might say, it is. The track I like to use for testing that is Reconnaissance by Mitch Murder. This track on something like an E-stat is nuts. So if I start playing this and skip to about 45 seconds in, I can turn that down. It's not massively fast, but it's also not like slow. It doesn't leave you feeling like there's anything missing, but there are definitely headphones that will do a little bit better in all kinds of driver types. I mean, I've got the HD800 at the moment there, and that would be something that's a lot faster. Obviously, this is an iem, so it's not a particularly fair comparison, but hey, as I said, this on E-stats is insane. And then the other thing is sub-bass extension, how weighty and authoritative it is, because, in fact, going on from E-stats, the problem with a lot of E-stats is that it's crazy fast, it's super snappy, it's super speedy, the initial snap and impact is great, but then there's nothing. There's no weight behind it, there's no authority, and it leaves you feeling like you've been slapped rather than punched. So let's go with Personal by Emotional Oranges. This track has quite a lot of sub-bass going on, so straight away. That bass kick at the beginning, it's not particularly fast, and it doesn't really matter what sort of can you play it on in terms of speed, but the actual force of it does change quite a bit. These do that very, very well. These are quite a good iem in terms of sub-bass extension. They feel very, very forceful. They feel very, very thunderous, almost. Sub-bass extension is great fun on these, and a lot of EDM music sounds really, really good as a result. EDM, you don't really need buckets of resolution or anything, and getting a little bit of speed and a lot of force going behind the bass really does bring that genre to life. These do that really, really well. I'll just quickly show one more track, and that's Anthology by Overwork. This has got a little bit of everything going on. Here we go. It's quite a long track, and takes inspiration from a lot of Daft Punk's work. Let's go to 116. The bass going on there is really something that shows the differences between different iems, different headphones, different speakers as well. That track on some speaker setup without a subwoofer versus with a subwoofer is a completely different track. And playing that on something like a dynamic driver versus a planar is, again, it's a completely different track. And these do a bloody brilliant job. The sub-bass extension on these is fantastic. And actually, that's one of the things that the Dusk has changed over the Blessing 2. Blessing 2 was tuned in collaboration with Crinical, who's a well-known iem reviewer, and I have the frequency response differences here. Green is the original Blessing 2, and blue is the Blessing 2 Dusk. As you can see, there's not a massive amount of difference over the treble, but the bass. Bass is significantly higher, and... Okay, so as I said, I've not tried the Blessing 2, so I can't give a direct comparison myself, but everyone I know who has tried both says that an EQ'd Blessing 2 does not sound like a Dusk, and that a Dusk sounds better. Can't comment any further on that, because as I said, I've not heard that with my own ears, but that does seem to be a pretty unanimous conclusion amongst everyone who's tried it, so keep that in mind. You can't just buy a Blessing 2, EQ it, and hope it sounds like this. The Dusk has absolutely fantastic sub-bass. It's pretty fast. It's not E-stat or highly resolving dynamic driver like an HD800 fast, but it is fast, and it doesn't leave you feel like anything's missing. The force, weight, and punch, though, is exceptional, and absolutely can't fault it there at all. So, moving up into mid-texture. This is something that, for me, is quite important in a lot of music. I struggle to enjoy music when timbre isn't presented in a realistic manner. And so let's go with Hozier. Hozier's music's quite good for this sort of stuff. Okay, so let's go with movement, and we're going to go to 152. And everything going on in the background is very, very separate. There's nothing that feels clustered together and incoherent. In fact, actually, the best track to demonstrate this is Pain by The War on Drugs. This track has a lot going on, and it's also, as you can see here, a little bit brick-walled. But the separation's so good. I don't quite know what's going on, but I love this track. The bass guitar, the regular guitar, the piano, the kick drums. The kick drum timbre is excellent as well. Everything sounds very, very realistic. The mid-resolution is good. The timbre is... Obviously, it's not going to be up to the level of a Susvara or anything, but for what you're paying, bear in mind, these are $300, it's excellent. And, again, cannot find anything to complain about here. I'm going to just leave it there for the mids. Treble. Treble is the only real place where I've got a couple slight nitpicks. So let's go with Best Behavior by Manchiner. Okay. This track sounds very, very spacious, and different cans present it in different ways. Something like an HD800, it's huge with very few intimate elements. Something like an Aria, there's quite a wide range. These, though... Everything is a little bit in your head. They don't stage very well. IEMs, you have to pay quite a bit to get good staging anyway. It's not something you'd expect from a sub-$500 IEM, usually. Air really is one of the areas where these don't do all that well. And if I bring up the frequency response again, you can see that past 10 kilohertz, it really does drop off quite hard. You can hear that. It is my only real complaint with these. I just wish they had a little bit more air. But, and it's a but, the layering, the texture, and the tactile imaging that these provide. If I go to 1 minute in. Makes up for it. I can just put some music on with these, let Rune Radio do its thing, and I don't pay attention. I don't listen for critical details. I don't feel like anything's missing at any point. I just put these in and listen. And that's what these are really good at. These are an absolutely amazing all-rounder. They're not resolution monsters. They don't give you buckets of detail and force-feed you technicalities like something like a Bayer Dynamic over ear or an Enola VX IEM would. Enola VX is amazing, though. I mean, that's not me saying that it's a clinical IEM. That's just me saying it's stupid resolving. These aren't resolution monsters. But again, I don't really care. Because everything else about them is so good and just works with every kind of music you can possibly throw at them. There's not been a single time I found these fatiguing. There's not been a single time I found these harsh. But there's been so many times when I've played a song and I just think, oh, that sounds good. It's warm. It's tactile. It's present. It's realistic. The 3D spacing isn't particularly realistic just because it's an IEM. It's, again, you have to pay a lot to get that on an IEM. But everything else is so good. And like I said, you can just put some music on and let some hours fall away. I've got some really resolving cans here at the moment. I've got the Zvara, the Aria, the HD100. And I've just been listening to these for hours on end because they're so much fun. These are a slightly warm, fun tuning without being overtly V-shaped. They don't shove fun into your ears. They don't try to sound kind of goofy or over the top like an Empire Ears Valkyrie. Those things are really, really fun for 5 minutes and then you get tired because they're absolute bass cannons. These you can just listen to for as long as you like. The real short version of this review is if you are looking to spend less than $500 on an IEM, this is it. There's nothing that these particularly do wrong. The only thing I can find to complain about them is that I wish the treble extension was a little bit better. But everything else, sub-bass extension is great. Speed and timbre of bass is good. Mid-texture is great. Timbre is great. Resolution is okay. Again, though, I have to keep reminding myself, these are $300. For the price, the resolution is great. And that's it. There's nothing I can complain about. They don't take much to drive. They're super comfy. These are fantastic. And I really have to try to find things to nitpick about, like the cable or the air, the fit, maybe. But again, I find them comfy. It's just if you have narrow ear canals. These are an exceptional IEM. Crinical and Moondrop have done an amazing job tuning these. And they sound fantastic. I highly recommend these to anyone thinking of getting an IEM under $500. If you're looking to spend more than that, there's some other good options. And if you're looking at, you know, over $1,000, then you've got stuff like the Mess to compete with, which are probably going to walk all over these. But if not, these are great. I just wanted to mention as well, these aren't an IEM which are super source dependent. It doesn't really matter what I plug these into, be it literal opposites, a Chord Dave and an M scaler, or a Holomay and JDS Atom, or just the Apple dongle. They sound good on everything. You don't need really resolving an expensive source gear to make these sound good. They're very forgiving without feeling laid back, and that means that they sound good on just about everything. As I said, Apple dongle works absolutely fine. I wouldn't recommend buying these and an expensive DAP. I would recommend buying these, something cheap like this, and then saving up for a better IEM later. There's no point spending 500 quid or 300 quid or whatever, or the same amount again, on a DAP for these. You don't need to do that. Anyway, that about sums up this review. This is a fantastically tuned, fantastically built IEM with a crap cable that sounds good with just about every genre I can possibly throw at it. No matter what... Come on, click, damn it. No matter what I played whilst I was testing these, nothing sounded harsh. Some stuff sounded a lot better than others, like EDM really does do well on these. But nothing sounded bad. These are an amazing all-rounder. I highly recommend them. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it.